Lions. Lions, lions, lions. They may be from Africa, but no matter where you go, you can find them. They're one of the world's favorite animals, and it shows. They're school mascots, sports mascots, in movies, kids' TV shows, anime, video games, books, outside of libraries and temples, in ancient Greek mythos, and in coat of arms of dozens of countries, are part of religious symbols. Hell! Even North Korea has their own little animated lion. And now this year, we got a remake of one of the most popular films about lions, which was...
And never return.
Let's just say it had poor animation direction. Anyways, with their ubiquity, you probably would think you know them pretty well, right? Well, throw that idea out the window, because hit it, Al! Hello, animal lovers. Welcome to the Zoology Girl channel.
And to another episode of the series, Species Summery.
I am your host, Strawbebeh, and today we'll be discussing everyone's favorite big cat and shedding the truth on all the myths on these animals you've heard over the years. Let's get started, shall we? So like all mammals, the class is Mammalia. Because it gives birth live and has a placenta instead of a pouch, its subclass is Eutheria. After that, it falls into the superorder Lorisotheria, as like all felines, its distant ancestors evolved from a species of mammal living in the northeastern hemisphere. Its order is obviously Carnivora, as like all members of this order, it has a kinasial pair and very powerful ones at that. Its suborder is Feliformia, which means feline-like form. And, well, it's a big cat. You can't get much more feline than that. It's maximum feline. Its family is Felidae, which is the cat family. All lesser and big cats belong to this. Its subfamily is Pantherinae, which is the group all big cats are a part of. They are a part of this due to their vocal cords and skull structure. I won't go too in-depth because the parts of the skull are a topic that needs a whole video to explain on its own. But anyways,
the hyoid bone in their jaw is not in the right shape.
Required to purr, like lesser cats, but have a single muscular vocal cord that allows them to roar. So first strike against Disney. They can't purr. Their genus is Pantheria, which is all the big cats except the clouded leopard. And this is why you can't call mountain lions panthers. There is no cat called a panther. It's a genus. And mountain lions aren't even in the genus Pantheria. It's a lesser cat. Back to the actual lions now. Finally, the African lion species name is Leo, which is Latin for lion. Yep. While there are some subspecies depending on where the lion is found in Africa, since the lion's range is huge, we have a lot to go over elsewhere, so we're gonna leave it there. The African lion is one of the biggest cats in the world, only outranked by the Siberian tiger. A full-grown male can grow to 10 feet long and weigh in at 570 pounds. They are extremely powerful cats, with strong muscles in their forelimbs and chest area that they use to knock or drag large prey to the ground and hold it there. Their back limbs are also very muscular, allowing them to run at speeds of up to 35 miles an hour, but only for short periods of time. The lion's most famous and striking feature is his mane, and as you probably have heard, the darkness and thickness of the mane shows how healthy the male is, thus making him more desirable to females looking for a mate. But there are many factors that go into how dark and thick a mane is. One is age. As lions get older, their manes get darker. Temperature is also a factor. Scientists have noted that the closer a lion lives towards the equator, the thinner and lighter his mane will be, as the heat would cause the male to overheat easily otherwise. Testosterone is also a factor. Testosterone levels can be directly linked to mane growth. If a male lion is neutered, his mane will completely fall out. Likewise, if a female lion experiences a hormonal imbalance that can cause increased testosterone levels in their body, they may begin to grow a mane. Lions are obligate carnivores, although they will occasionally eat wild melons for a source of water. That being said, they can't just eat any kind of meat in the savannah. Lions require a fairly lean diet. Too much fat can make them horribly sick. This is why, in general, lions are not man-eaters. Humans are just too fatty for them. When a human gets killed by a lion, usually it's out of defense for its territory. White and black lions are a popular subject in media, much like white tigers are. However, there is no such thing as a truly black lion. lions do not have the genes of total melanism, or overproduction of melanin in their body, like many other species do. Usually the photos you see are edited in Photoshop. When melanism does appear in lions, usually it's in the form of having an especially dark mane. White lions, on the other hand, are totally real. They have a condition called leucism, where melanin and other pigments are largely absent from the body. Leucism is different from albinism, but we'll talk about that more another time. Beautiful they may be, but these lions don't survive well in the wild due to their coat causing them stand out, so they are rarely seen. Here's where we talk about the bulk of misconceptions about lions. There are some things that are true, like they're one of the few social cats out there and hunt together, but that's usually where the accuracy stops. We'll start with the most well-known myth first. Lions are the king of the jungle. Nope, that title goes to the Bengal tigers. Because lions don't live in the jungle. They live in savannas, scrublands, some deserted areas, some mountainous areas, and a few unique cases where ones live in deciduous forests and near beaches. But they do not live in jungle habitats. To be honest, lions aren't really the kings at all since they don't have a patriarchal system, but a matriarchal one, much like elephants. Yep, that's myth number two. Male lions have very little power in their pride, and are less a king and more like a knight for hire that the queen fell in love with. One of the oldest mothers in a pride is usually the leader of the group, and males will come and go, depending on if they're being a good protector, how long they live, and whether their children are grown or not. So they usually only stick around for a few years. Meanwhile, pride leadership is passed down among female relatives in the pride. Now for myth number three, males do nothing. While it is true male lions do not generally hunt for a pride, they aren't totally useless. They take their jobs as fathers fairly seriously compared to most mammals in the animal kingdom, and love their cubs. Their role is to protect the cubs while females are hunting, as they can easily make a tasty snack for wild dogs, hyenas, and other large predators. But their main job is to keep away other male lions. Yeah, the thing about bachelor male lions that come upon an unprotected pride is... well, they tend to commit infanticide of the cubs that aren't theirs. Looks like Scar was better than most male lions, seeing as he never killed Nala or the other cubs in the pride. Most likely. Now that being said, they do this for a reason. Not a great reason, but a reason. Females with cubs will not accept a foreign male into their pride, whether or not there is a male there already, and will not mate with him. He'd have to wait until the cubs are grown to do that. Or he can kill the cubs and they'll welcome him in and mate with him within about 3 days, because lion biology is screwed up like that. And when you're a lone male who is statistically more likely to die when not in a pride than a lone female, yeah, as sick as it is, you can see why they evolved that way. That being said, male lions can take care of themselves on their own. It's just a lot harder. They can hunt, but their mane makes it harder to hunt, both by making them more obvious and causing them to not have as much stamina as the females. This means males are more likely to go after larger, more calorie-rich, yet also more dangerous hunts, like the Cape buffalo, then tire themselves out on faster, smaller meals that won't last them as long. And although females do most of the hunting when it comes to pride life, males will get involved when they go after larger, more dangerous prey, such as the aforementioned Cape buffalo or hippos, but these occasions are rare. Speaking of hunting, another myth is that lions always hunt their meals. That's really not true. Although they hunt in coordinated ways, they are more likely to scavenge their meals and to save energy, particularly lone males. Back onto pride structure, there isn't one set structure, like what we think of, like one male with multiple females. Sometimes a pride is only one male and female. Sometimes it's all females. Sometimes it's the traditional polygynous image we have. Sometimes there are multiple males in a pride. Although in those cases, usually one male still gets the ladies. The other males are usually his brothers, who are just there for free food. And on some occasions, there can be all male bachelor groups too. Because actually, if they don't have a pride, male lions get along pretty well with each other most of the time. Phew! That was a lot to cover. The next part is probably gonna be even more of a mess. Help? So, pretty much every culture east of the international dateline has known about lions forever. So, I'm gonna cut it to some more notable examples and ones people just haven't heard of. The earliest known depiction of lions dates back to a little ivory carving in Germany of a cave lion from over 32,000 years ago. Lions are everywhere in myth and legend, often being associated with strength, royalty, and courage, from Iran and early Mesopotamia all the way to the English monarchy, and they often still hold that symbolism today. Some cultures saw them as representative of divine beings. Early Egyptians used them to represent gods and goddesses such as Bastet, who eventually became a cat goddess, but used to be represented by a lioness. Moving southward in Africa, lions were sometimes hunted as a test of courage and hunting prowess, such as in the Maasai ethnic group. While they never used the meat of a lion, they would use the claws, mane, and tail for decoration and in ceremonies. However, this was a rare, carefully planned out event, and it was only males that were hunted, never females, unless one posed a threat to the community. Killing lions was seen as a test of strength other places too, as gladiators would battle them, although usually they were expected to lose. Heroes like Hercules and Samson fought them in Greek and biblical myth, and often many of the most powerful monsters that had been defeated in myth took some aspects of lions into their forms, such as the manticore, griffin, and chimera. In East Asia, it's common to see lion dog statues outside of temples and official buildings, standing as protectors of the land. And during the Lunar New Year, a lion dance is performed in China in celebration to ring in the new year. India even has Asiatic lions as a symbol of their country, and many others have lions featured in their coat of arms, from nations in Africa all the way up to Finland and Europe. But in the 1800s, things began to change for the lions. During that time, the race for Africa was going on, and the European powers at the time were carving up Africa and its people like a Christmas turkey as quickly as their greedy little mitts could. Something became a trend among the imperialist elite that really started to affect the African animal populations: big game hunting and the exportation of animals and animal parts. And while everything from elephants to hippos were on the menu for these trigger-happy men, lions were a real prized item along with the rhino horns and elephant ivory. After all, what Victorian man with fragile masculinity and more money to throw around than the entirety of the English working class at the time wouldn't want the King of Beasts' head hanging over his fireplace as a show of his strength and triumph over nature, or have his pelt as a rug, or turn it into a footstool? Hell, why not have the animal live in a tiny cage in their own backyard? Now that would be a conversation starter. And so the trend spread all over the white Western world, and back to Africa, where impoverished Africans and other minorities exploited by the system realized they could make a decent living poaching animals instead of living in less than squalor, and thus began the roots of the illegal exotic trade as we know it today. That, along with the clearing of land from farming, killing prey items, and killing lions, either through intervention when contact is made between them and humans, killing them out of fear, or accidentally killing them via cars, has caused a significant drop in their numbers, although they aren't actually considered endangered yet as a whole, but some subspecies are, such as the Asiatic lion. Meanwhile, others, like the Barbary lion, are extinct entirely. Scientists believe that the rapid decline will continue, in part because of the effects of hunting lions. Studies have shown that hunters are picking off males with the largest and healthiest manes to bring home as their prizes. As manes are an indicator of health of a male lion, this means that the healthy gene pool is shrinking significantly, and nasty genetic defects and health problems may become more common in wild lions in the future, which in turn could cause the population to become fragile, much like the cheetah. While controlled big game hunting does have some benefits to conservation, such as the money people pay for going on a hunt, going back to state parks, or communities in which the hunting was done, if we want lion populations to remain healthy and stick with us for many years to come, we may need to rethink our stance on hunting lions.
Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, consider subscribing or supporting me on Patreon. If you want to join a community on studying a bunch of different sciences and topics, consider clicking the invite link to the Study Q&T Discord in the description below. But most importantly, have a wonderful day.